them steps, 10 of the country's fastest three-year-olds in a battle royal for the blue ribbon of harness racing. Also, plenty of jacks. They're breaking all-time marks on this track. Real smart drivers jockeying for position. And the crowd is getting an eyeful of the prettiest pacing duel ever staged. They're nearing the finish now, and Hanover's Bertha the favorite is fighting for the lead. She's getting it. She's got it. More horsepower to her. Hear that crowd.
Hanover's Bertha. I just won with her. I'm awful glad I won. I won $36,000 this afternoon.
Hamiltonian State with seven crack three-year-olds running start in America's greatest fighting classic. There they go, stepping smartly around the track, hitting a pace that's going to make this a battle royal for the lead. Right now it looks like Inverness. Yes, it is Inverness in the lead with the others pressing him hard. Hollyroof Dennis and the Marchioness are coming up a bit. The Marchioness, Invader, and Hollyroof Dennis are now fighting it out for that $60,000 purse. Watch those trotters step. Look at the horses on the outside coming up now, taking a spectacular challenge for the lead. Smooth, fast stride, perfect pacing, and they're coming into the final stretch. Brakes and heats have narrowed the field to three. The Marchioness is in the lead, showing her authority. And coming on like the wind to finish first. Champion of the three-year-olds, winning a well-deserved victory.
$5,000 are here for America's richest trotting classic, the Hamiltonian, and there they go. Swift as the wind, they pass the stands carrying the mingled hopes of farm and city fans who have come for miles to see this blue ribbon event. As they round the turn for the backstretch, the leaders are well bunched, but Lord Jim, one of the favorites, is setting a terrific pace. On his toes as we hit the far turn, paced by a flock of frightened birds. The slow motion camera shows you the struggle of the straining horses as the pounding hoofs dig into the soft earth. On come the three-year-olds, a picture of grace and flashing form, with their drivers urging them to their utmost in the thrilling battle for cash and glory. The finish. Under the whip, Lord Jim leaps ahead for the $26,000 stake. 1934's King of the Trotters.
What's the difference between a trotter and a pacer? Well, a pacer goes with its front leg, and the hind leg goes the same size. Or a trotter just goes the opposite.
Oh, that's clear.
Forget Dan for a moment, and meet young Gibson White, his filly Rosalind, and his dad Ben, who grazed her today. It was the father's gift of the horse to his son that made the boy fight to live when desperately ill. Dan's heard about the White, and decides to get inside info.
Hello, Mr. White. There's Rosalind, the favorite, isn't it?
That's her, and I think she's going in.
Well, Dan's a skeptical cuss, and he decides to check up with his friend, Governor Hoffman of New Jersey.
Say, Governor, who do you like?
For sentiment rise on, for business, Ed Lasseter.
Ed Lasseter, Mike Phillips.
What is Ed Lasseter to say?
Gonna win today? I'll get a bet on you.
45,000 ruralites and city slickers watch the cream of the Trotters Parade, and as they get away, nearly everybody but Dan roaring for old Ben as he lines Rosalind up for the leader. Dan's horse falls behind as he hits the back stretch. Rosalind leads. Nobody in the crowd rooting harder than young Mr. White. Here a father and son story that outpaces fiction is being acted as old Ben at 62 drives for his boy at 20.
Come on, Ed Lasseter!
On comes Rosalind, breaking the record. Old Ben's the only driver to win this classic fight, and he brings nearly $20,000 to his boy.
Did you put it on the ground?
No, I got all mixed up.
I gave it to you.
Sad day for Dan, but for the White, the happiest of their lives. Father and son share the perfect ending to a perfect racing drama.
Time track for the Kentucky Derby of harness racing, the Hamiltonian, is staged every August. Thousands of strangers motor in. Strangers, well, they're not really strangers, because they have a community of interest, a spirit in the harness game. This is the big day for horse owners and horse lovers, farmers and breeders, and Slick City folks. They're different from running horse people, more homelike, more down-to-earth. The midway's packed with them. The stables attract uncounted throngs. What are they all talking about? Why, about the odds on DeSoto the favorite, 6-5. But just wait till they see Shirley Hanover. She's our horse, and we'll be rooting her home. Well, it's time to go. The race is almost ready to start. Come on, let's find our seats in the grandstand and watch the pre-race parade. Here they come, while a howl of appreciation bursts from the serried ranks of horse lovers. That's DeSoto leading, with his rivals following. A chain of beauty to stop one's breath. They're high-stepping conquerors of the track. Aristocrats, every one. Where's Shirley Hanover? There she is, number 9. Great, isn't she? Come on, do your stuff, Shirley. The race calls for a running start. So the drivers head their horses the reverse way of the track. Excitement's growing in the stands. Come on, let's make this a perfect start. All right, swing into your positions now. That's the stuff. Now straighten them out for the getaway. Here they come. It looks like it's going to be a good one. They're under a full head of steam now. Yep, he's letting them go. They're off. The field thunders on in a sun-trimmed blanket of dust. Cadence Cook setting the pace for Drumming Heart. There isn't a person in that vast crowd who isn't cheering for one of the thoroughbreds. Someplace back in the welter, lost for a moment in the melee of straining horses, is Shirley Hanover. Come on there, baby. The sulky wheels spin out their thread-like song. Slim legs, weaving rhythm and grace into tremendous driving power. In the backstretch, the heroes of the Hamiltonian, seeking record, fortune, fame. Shirley begins to step on it now, passing one horse after the other. Faster, faster, baby. Here's where speed and training and courage blend into winning effort. Those sunny days in the Pennsylvania hills gave you what you need, so come on, you trotting beauty, you come on. Here's where you put on the pressure. The straining, sweat-leathered champions roll round the last turn into the home stretch. Any half a dozen can still win. Tight open race. Look, look, there's our darling. There's Shirley Hanover. He's second. forgotten all the sweat and effort and expense. For here is the queen of the life harness game.
In 1938, the next year, where Henry won back-to-back Hamiltonians. First, this year is worth around $38,000, and Henry won with McLynn Hanover. Earl's Princess Martha, Beck Hurst driving. She is owned by Spears Shropshire, and Champlain, owned by William Hughes and driven by Dick Fleming, was third. Henry did a tremendous job with this horse. He bought him from Walter Cox two or three weeks, or Mr. Shepherd did. And he went on and won the Hamiltonian with him. See Henry there, he won it pretty convincingly now. I looked up and there's Dick Thomas with his dad right there. And I looked up to see. Now this race, the parading for the 1941 Hamiltonian that was raced in August, or 1940 Hamiltonian that raced August the 14th, is won by Spencer Scott, driven by Fred Egan. He's owned by C.W. Fellows. And the horse that was second in the race, Bo Peep, was Remus. Nice big pull by Protector. And Harry Short drove and owned a piece of them with Billy Dickerson and Paul Bowser. Kuno, the 3-3 in the race. Queen Victoria owned the Bill Strang with Ben White with 4-7. And Princess Pert was 9-4. Dick Fleming and Milestone owned the Joe Neville and Jim by Charlie Smart was 6-5. Now there's Clem McCarthy. I'm sure he was the announcer that day. Clem was a pretty good announcer and did a lot of announcing for our trotting races at Goshen and Roosevelt Raceway, but these are good pictures of the coach. And you see there was there, you see Harry Short with white colors finishing the race. And there you'll see Mr. Egan go in the winner's circle. That's Mr. Mooney on Fred's left there. And Mr. Fellas, the owner there, 41 Hamiltonian. His Excellency won the first heat. There's Ben right there, His Excellency. And he was 1-2-2. But Bill Gallen with Lee Smith won the race. He was 6-1-1. The purse was $38,729. Marijuana by Scotland with Dick Fleming was right there. Is, Lee Smith with Bill Gallen winning that heat, and you can see Ben finish in second. 43 Hamiltonian, which you'll see on the cassette. And I spent a lot of time last week, spent a whole afternoon down getting the tapes kind of separated because they had been spliced together wrong at one time, and the first heat was first, and the last heat, the second, it was all messed up. So I think we got them in pretty good shape now. Although there's duplication of a lot of heats. Now there you'll see the crowd rising for the national anthem. And right after that, you'll see probably a replay of one of the heats in the Hamiltonian. But all these tapes were put together, and I think they used them. Made them from two different angles, and instead of cutting them up or doing anything with them, I didn't want to ruin Benny's old film and want to keep all this for posterity because this is something good to have. And anybody wants to, will see it at the Hall of Fame because I give up an original of all of these to the Hall of Fame, and they'll have them all up there to show them on screen. This is what he does talking about. And I'm sure this is, you'll see Ben there on the outside, and that is Volo's song, because in all these things you'll see Volo's song with the shadow on. Now there's the starter stand, and I'm not sure, I think Steve Phillips was doing the starting in those days, and they did have a lot of scoring, you'll see, although Volo's song was a favorite, you'll find a lot of scoring in the races, and the heat after the heat, there'll be a lot of scores, although it don't show quite all of them, it shows a good many of them, and you'll think they're away, then they're coming back. Now, here they are parading for the first heat, and you'll see, maybe notice the first horse there, he had the real position, was Polo's song, because he has a shadow on him. And right there, number six, is Worthy Boy, who also was the son of Bolo, might like Bolo's song, and he won the first heat. Now you'll see some of the, what we went through in the old days with the old scoring system. Now you'll see time after time after time, it looks like they're going to get away, and they don't. And somewhere in the first heat, Lolo's song made a break, and he did come on to finish third. Now here we go again, and I think this may be the, see that might be him making a break there at the rail now. I think you'll see him go on. This heat will be the first heat of the Hamiltonian that was won by Worthy Boy in August 11, 1943. I had seen Bolo song race and was great admirer of his. I saw him race in 42 before it went in. And then what a two-year-old he was, and he was a great three-year-old. Unfortunately, Mr. Baker sold him to, or Mr. Strang sold him to Mr. Baker. And they were given an exhibition with him next year during the war and at Elkhorn, Wisconsin. He broke a leg and they had to destroy him. He could have been the greatest son of Roland, because I think he was the greatest trotter by him. And that's gotten a lot of good trotters, too. You can see this heat here now. Comes around. And through the stretch, you'll see he come pretty close. Maybe somebody coming up on him pretty good, or he's just getting by him. And the other horse looked like he was coming on again, made a break, and I'm not sure. I don't have all my old horse papers down here to read and to see who that was. But he made a break right there. You'll see him stepping on the wind by two or three. Four or five lengths. In all these races, you'll see replays. I mean, I don't know whether it was the other cameras or whether they use them for the judges. And this is a replay of the... No, this isn't a replay. This is the second heat, but we'll see a lot of replays. This is the second heat, and they're scoring for the second heat. You'll see Ben there with... his shadow on his horse. Right behind him right there is Gibson White driving Gordon Gray. Now they're going to get off this time. And I don't know who that was get off on top. It might have been Hester Hanover with Harry Parnell. She got 6 money out of the race. This is the back stretch at still, you can see it very plainly at Yonkers. and around about where they, before you get to three-quarter pole behind that, they have a jog track there now. And it's just too bad that it couldn't have been kept a mile track, because I think Mr. Levy had the idea that everybody wants to see horse on a half-mile track, but that shown in Meadowlands that he was wrong, and it would have been a lot less money spent. They could have put that down, made it a little lower, and maybe put stalls in the infield there, and they had a lot more room or parking in the infield. And that might have been one of the greatest things ever happened to trotting. They never put a half-mile track in there. Now you see them winning that second heat pretty easily. You can see it was a good easy going horse. And the horse that finished second there was, now this is a replay of the race. The horse that finished second in the race was Phonograph, driven by Tommy Berry. Set was third the second heat. Now this is just another replay of the second heat. And these are good to have. Somebody wants to cut them out of their tape and make it just a one race would be easily enough to do. But I didn't want to fool with the film. And I just thought I'd put it all on so everybody could see everything, see how much we scored everything in those days. Now this is the parade again from another angle of the first heat. And we get to see that once again. It might be a little boring, but a person can, if you have a radio cassette, you can speed it up when you want to see it a little faster, or else, as I said, get a copy made and take out some of this. But I would keep the old original one because it does show, as I said, all the scoring and gives people an idea that a lot of people racing horses, driving trotters, and pacers today, they never had the fun of racing and scoring like we, like they are doing there. I know I've been in races where I scored 25 or 30 times. Sometimes it scored a lot and you had to wait and go the next day. And this was only in 43, and I think Steve finally got his gate out in 45. And that first seen Steve's starting gate in 36, and nobody seemed to want it. But I did hear Cox say to Steve after 3 or 4 Hamiltonian and Goshen. Cox came up to him kind of gruff talking man. He said, Steve, he said, I didn't like that damn contraption you had at North Vannel, but he said, since I've seen it and you've got it and started 3 or 4 Hamiltonian with it, I think it's the greatest thing that ever happened to trotting. And I wholeheartedly agree with Walter Cox that hadn't been for a starting gate, we'd never have been as far as we are today with racing. I said before, this is heat, or the first heat, when Seth went with Worthy Boy. The first 3 horses in the race, the finish first, second, and third, Bolo Song, Worthy Boy, and Phonograph, were all by Bolomite. So you can see how much Bolomite predominated in a race like this. Anyone that they have the old periodicals and stuff can get out your old horse papers now and your old yearbooks and you can read and read about all the heats and everything. They cover them well in those days. And the first time I get up home to my library, I'll look up and see who that was that made the break. coming home there. Probably might have been placed third. Or fourth, probably. May have been placed back for the net. Now this is a replay again of the second heat in Bolo Song 1. One of these pictures, you can see the big water tower that's still up behind there. It's off the Parkway now in New York. And those trees are still there. There you can see some of the Bimbleville back in the background. I'd gone by Empire City there 4 or 5 years before this on the way to Old Orchard once and stopped in there in the afternoon and saw the thoroughbred races. And then they quit racing there, and that's when they bought the racetrack and changed the name of it and built a half-mile track and called it Yonkers Raceway. And then they sent one of these cassettes to Tim so we'll see what went on at his track years ago. But don't forget, in all these races, when you see a horse with the shadow of it on, it was roller song, because Ben told me once that it wasn't the jump shadows, more that when dirt hit him on the, around his eyes, he didn't like it, and that kind of stopped it. Now here is the last heat. I'm sure this is the last heat of the Hamiltonian. They didn't show the parades, only the one parade. And they did run and show the replay of that, which you see a lot of us are making breaks, and but they ran and got them right out of the way. But there you see men kind of just beating them up easy. Now you see them coming into the winter circle. Now for years, the winter circle at the half-mile track was on the other side, or didn't have much of a winter circle. But now, Tim Rooney has put in a winter circle, and I haven't been there since they put it in, but I think it's in about this same area. You'll see Bill Strang, who was a good friend of Lalo's for years. Especially the great when he got Roosevelt Raceway at Wimbledon. Was there every night until he passed away. He lived in Brooklyn, was one of the first people, firms, the big Strang warehouse that would haul horses in vans. They had a big warehouse over there. But there he is getting his, I think that's Len Newbley at the horse's head.
Now this is the Hamiltonian. It was raced August the 9th, 1944, for a purse of $33,577. And it was won by Yankee Maid, again driven by Henry Thomas. And she was owned by A.L. Derby of Wichita, Kansas. Emily Scott, owned by Mr. C.W. Fellis and driven by Fred Egan, was 2-4. Enac was owned by Mr. Kane and driven by Harry Whitney, was 11-2. Paul Vineyard drove Roos Day, that colt by Guy Day, owned by Aaron F. Williams, was 5-3, and Seth Palin had Rapid Hanover, by Dean Hanover, owned by Mr. and Mrs. James B. Johnson, was Francis Van Lennep. Was 3-7. Now you can see Henry got right off on top and went on and He won in straight heats in 2-5 and 2-4. There'll be another race on here, and it'll be a more detailed race on Shirley Hanover. It's another film that I got from Dick Thompson to show some stuff about Hanover Shoe Farm, but there is audio on that, which is nice. But you can see Henry there winning. And it was nice that Mr. Derby was a wonderful person, a good owner from out in Wichita, and had won the backbone of the old circuit out there in the old days. See right there, it was great to look up these books and find out their numbers, because that was number 4 Yankee Made and driven by Henry. There's the second heat now. Now see, these were on movie tone, but somehow or the other film gets old and it lost the video. See, Seth made a break with Rapid Animal there. And this would be the second heat. And that's the heat that Enoch was second. I think that's Enoch right there with Harry Whitney with the elbow boots on. Going into the winner's circle. Sixth Hambletonian race at Goshen, New York, August 8, 1946. This is the first Hambletonian, incidentally, the first Hambletonian I ever drove in. I raced Don Scott for Mr. Reynolds, and he was 4-3-8. Chestertown Warner. He was 2-1-1. Victory Song won the first heat. He was 1-9-2. Deanna, Ben Mitro for Gib White and Mr. Shepherd, Lawrence, Sonny Shepherd owned her. She was 3-2-3. I was 4-3-8. Westfield Girl, Bavola Mike, was 10-4-4. Walter Spencer was 5-6-6. There was 4 or 5 other starters. Times are 2-3, 2-2.5, and 2-3.25. And the purse was a little over $50,000. Chestertown, I know, won the, second and third heat, and Victory Song won the first heat. There I am, facing third with Don Scott in that heat that we just raced there. Now here, I think, is the third heat. In this heat, I got to the front, and Seth kind of raised heck. He'd won the first heat. I let Ben go, and I was trying to get all I could get to Mr. Reynolds for us, and Ben was owned by a different party, so it wasn't really an entry. And Seth blamed me afterwards for getting the beat, said I was out help, trying to help Ben. With Seth was just a little crybaby, and that reason, because Tommy just out-trotted him. You can see there, he had a chance right there, and Tommy got him to beat him, so. Seth had to have a little excuse, and I remember he jumped on me that night. I was out, and Jimmy Johnson and Francis Johnson performed. That is Tommy in the Winner's Circle, and that's Mrs. Smith, Walter Smith's wife, the people that own Chestertown. Chestertown got 28,007 Hamiltonian that was won by Hootman, Seth Palin driving. And this year, Seth trained at Colt in California for Mr. and Mrs. Jimmy Johnson, who afterwards Mrs. Van Lennep. And Colt got lame after the race from once back east early in June. And he didn't race again until the Hamiltonian. The week before, Steph trained him in 2-2 for the Hamiltonian. I'd step right there with Hootmar. And that was a pretty good job of getting the horse ready to go three heats without having to race. And the favorite in that race was, one of the favorites was Rodney, who he beat that day. But Sepp did win a $3,000 race with him, a stake with him in California that year. And he was second to Rodney on June the 20th before he got lame. Now the Hamiltonian that year was raced August the 6th, 1947 for a purse of $46,000. Hooten won the 2-1-1. Rodney was five shy of his guy, 1-2-2. Way Yonder, the Phil Fleming guy for Gameplay Farm, was 8-3-3. Buckshot B, Frank Safford, was 3-6-4. And there were seven money winners that year. He was nominated for Ward's $850. Now you can see him leading. And this heat, Rodney won. 2-1-2 with the last quarter in just 30 seconds. But Sepp went away, and I read where Sepp said he timed and won the piece and came from behind to win the second heat. But this is the first heat with the Vi Shavi one. Now there's Vi right there with Rodney. Clint Hodgman driving in the race with Scott Sissel and Bolo Stone. Fred Egan had, I think that might have been Grand Parade, the one on the outside there with Harry Fitzpatrick. But you'll see some horse there made it, you know, it caught. Yeah, that was Sepp on the outside. Looked like he made a break and caught, but you can see Vi won it pretty easily with Rodney, and Sepp was second. Now you can see Vi after winning the first heat there. Funny, Mr. Fellows raised this colt and sold him to Castle and Farm for $50,000. Then after, next year, Castle and sold him to Handel the Shoe Farm where he stood all his life. And they sold him for $50,000 after winning the Hamiltonian. Fred Egan had him the year before, and I don't know why. I guess Fred just, where they thought he couldn't beat Rodney or something, but they did sell him for $50,000. There you can see the old Good Time Park track. A lot of shade up there. And it's just one of the unfortunate things that it was moved away from there when it was. See, there's Vi on top again with Rodney, but Hootenmon comes right around this time, and that's Del Cameron in their third. And you'll see Hootenmon just tries by him. You see the old street behind. There's right back there. You can see Fred Egan's old barn where he was stable all done. Now you can see him coming through by where the grandstand and the awnings were. There you get a pretty good look at the crowd, and there's Sepp kind of buggy riding in 2 minutes. And to that, afterwards, he's done in 59 in the season. course, you can lead better from the outside than you could be from the rail, because if the outside is playing clean across in front of the horses, there's your old front turn. This is pretty sharp. It's kind of a three-turn track. It's a turn there, then a, you can see it's kind of a sharp, not a real big first turn. And then you come down the back stretch, kind of the other stretch, and you come into another pretty sharp turn right there where they're going around now. Then you went on up towards Red Barn, and there is another turn now. That's Del Cameron again. Size in third, and I think that's Fred in the two hole. And then you had another turn right around there before you came home. So there were really three turns on a mile track. But they had a good long stretch, which was helpful. If you didn't get out there, you hardly ever get out in any stretch. So Vi tried him again, but the big old horse couldn't make it that day. But he was a good trotter, too. So there's the winner there, Putin on. You'll see the winner circle, and you'll see Francis and Jimmy Johnson. And in those days, Doc Vega from around Hamburg, New York, would be announcing. There was a caretaker. I knew him well. And you'll see Mr. Harriman come up and shake hands. That's Mr. Harriman right there. That's Doc Baker right there. And some of the others I don't recognize. Jimmy and Francis basically was happy as a lark. I don't blame her. She's a wonderful sportswoman, man. She was great for our game. Brought that nice farm of cattle and brought it back. And she and Freddie kept it. I mean, just made a great breeding establishment out of it. I don't know whether that was on the governor, the politician, or I haven't seen Mr. Phillips, but there's Jimmy. And you can see the Hamiltonian trophy. In those days, you'd go to Goshen and go out to eat all the time, racing daytime. There's Roger Duncan, that one time president of the USA, right behind Francis's left shoulder. Roger Duncan came from around Hartford. And that's the end of the 1947 Hamiltonian.
$60,000 stake. The best in trotters brings out the best in drivers. Men like Seth Palin, three-time Hamiltonian winner, and Tom Berry, twice winner. And the old master, Ben White, the only four-time winner. Yes, it's a fast field for man and beast. For the first time in Hamiltonian history, an amateur driver, Harrison Hoyt, with his horse, Demon Hanover, is entered and is also the favorite. This Demon horse was sired by that great Gene Hanover we showed you back on the farm. The Hamiltonian goes for the best three-year-old trotter who first wins two heats on the one-mile track. Hoyt and his speed demon won the first heat with ease. Now the question on every fan's mind is, can he repeat? Can he do it again? you're in the driver's seat.
Anyway, course. But you both raced against the clock. So far. You're Bayon Shively, and you were harness racing 15 years before Arizona entered the Union. Maybe now, when folks offer you sympathy, what they really mean is goodbye.
Tired, the hand of a
see him get ready for the second heat.
Thank you. fall to the wayside. Here they come now, and they're off. Simpson elects to go to the front with Hickory Smoke, and Baldwin and Hoopsong offer no resistance. This race off will be a battle of driving strategy as well as a test of each man's and horse's ability. The early pace will be assuredly moderate, as it is now, but at some later stage, probably somewhere between the halfway point and the top of the stretch, Baldwin will shake the lines at Hoopsong, and she will come out after the leader. And then, two of the finest young trotters the sport has known in a long while will battle it out head and head for the highest honors harness racing can bestow. Victory in the Hambletonian. The first quarter time was 34 2/5. Racing down the back stretch now, it's Hickory Smoke, Johnny Simpson up by a length. Hoopsong with Ralph Baldwin up right in behind. And Simpson is looking for his first Hambletonian victory as he races Hickory Smoke right down to the halfway mark. Hoopsong right in, ready to challenge. And, of course, the drivers could challenge at any point in the mile, but usually they'll wait until right around this turn. 1/8 3/5 was the halftime, and Hoopsong could now come out at any moment, or Baldwin might elect to wait until the three-quarter. We'll see. Here's Hickory Smoke in the turn now. Hoopsong is right there as they come in. Baldwin is not going to wait. He's out now. He's moving with Hoopsong. Hickory Smoke's on the inside, and Simpson shakes Hickory Smoke up. Here comes Hoopsong. They're racing head and head now in that far turn. Hits Hickory Smoke around the turn as they come to the three-quarters. Hoopsong on the outside, and they're head and head now. They're neck and neck. Hickory Smoke and Hoopsong for the Hambletonian. Which one will it be? Hickory Smoke's on the inside. Hoopsong's on the outside as they come down by the eighth-mile pole. Hits Hickory Smoke and Hoopsong. Either one of them could do it. Hits Hickory Smoke on the inside. He seems to be stronger at this point. Hoopsong, however, is right there trying to come on. Hits Hickory Smoke and Hoopsong. Hickory Smoke seems to be getting it all now as they come for the last